Till now we have looked at finite state automata. In this lecture we are starting with a new type of a machine which is called push down automata. So before starting with push down automata, let's recap certain things. Finite state automata talked about regular languages. We have seen that if we are given a regular language, then we can make a deterministic finite automata for this language. So we can make a deterministic finite automata which recognizes this language. We can make an NFA which recognizes this language, and we have seen that DFAs and NFAs were equivalent. Basically, you could convert any NFA to a DFA. Then we have looked at regular expressions, and we have seen that you can make a regular expression to recognize a regular language. After that, we studied the concept of grammar. We have looked at type 0, type 1, 2, 3 grammars. We looked at we studied about context-free grammar, and we also studied about regular grammar. So regular grammar is actually fourth way which you can use for regular languages. Mainly you can write a regular grammar which recognizes a regular language. Just to recap, your regular grammar is the one whose all the production rules are of this form. Context-free grammar has no such foundations. Context-free grammar should basically have a non-terminal or a variable at your left-hand side, and right-hand side can be any string. Then we have seen that context-free grammar can actually recognize certain languages which are not regulars. So you should see two things. So any context-free grammar is definitely a regular grammar. So context-free grammar can recognize the regular languages. In addition, context-free grammar can recognize some more languages. So if we talk about context-free grammar, so it can recognize regular languages plus some additional languages. Still not all the languages in your Sigma Star, not all. Let's take an example. Let's talk about this very well-known language. We have seen that we cannot make a regular grammar, regular expression, or a finite state automata corresponding to this. The reasons we have seen. So if we bound the value of n here, so if I fix the value of n to be 10, you can make a finite state automata. Or if I give you a condition like n is less than equals to 20, again you can make a finite state automata for this language. But for n is greater than equals to 0, we can't make a finite state automata. Why? Because here n goes up to infinity, and as n goes up to infinity, then I should have infinite number of states in the automata which I am making. So that's not possible. In other words, our finite state automata has a very limited memory. So whatever work you have to do, whatever you have to memorize, so all the memorization work is done with the help of your states. You do not have any additional memory. So these are states, and states provide you a very limited concept of memory. Hence, you can also say it like your finite state automata can actually not count. So if it was able to count the number of A's, it would recognize this language A and B N. So we cannot make a finite state automata for this language. However, we have seen a context-free grammar for this language. We have seen that if I have a grammar which goes like this, with just this production rule, so this grammar can generate all the strings in this language A and B N. Pushdown automata is nothing, but you can say that it's a more advanced version of a finite state automata. So let's put the question to this. So we have seen the basic architecture of how a finite state automata looks. we have a input tape. Input tape is the one on which we write our input string. So my input string can be something like this. Then we have a finite control here. So this control, you can say it implements my entire machine, which was a 5-tuple machine. Initially it points to the first square of my input tape, right? And now what happens, as I keep on reading my input, so this control, this actually implements a logic. As I read this input, my states keep changing. So by the time I am at the last symbol of my input, if I am in the final state, my string is considered to be accepted, else rejected. Now what change can I do to this machine so that I can remember things? So how can I impart it a memory? So what pushdown automator does is, it just introduces one additional component of memory here with the help of a stack. Stack you would have studied in your data structure. It's analogous to one placing plates in a cafeteria. So you can always access only the topmost element. So if you have to insert something in the stack, you are going to do it at the topmost place. If you want to remove something from the stack, you are again going to pop it from the top. Now this finite control can also access this stack. So what it does is, in the case of a finite state automata, it was just reading my input, and based on the input and the current state, my state will change. We will talk more about it in the next lecture when we look at the formal definition of a pushdown automata. The whole point here is, this finite control pointed to the tape. It was only concerned with the tape. In our case now, it has a stack also. So now its moves are not just dependent only on the input tapes. The moves of my machine depends on both the things, your input tape as well as the stack. So I can, if I want to informally write it, I can write it like, the moves of my machine, they are a function of your input tape as well as your stack. Further, input tape is still read only, so I cannot write anything on this input tape. I can only read the symbols from the input tape, and I keep reading till I reach the last symbol. If we talk about stack, you can read as well as you can write to this stack. So at any point of time, I can actually insert things in this stack, and I can also remove things from this stack. So that is the additional functionality in a pushdown automata. Now how does it help us? Let's talk about the string we were working with, making that as our base example. So if we have this string ANBN. So in the case where this memory was not there, we cannot implement it, because in the case I don't have a memory, I need to have an infinite number of states here in this control, which is not possible. Now when I have a memory, I can use this memory to count the number of A's. So what I can do is, as soon as I read an A in the input tape, I'm going to do it like this to give you an example. If this is my stack, assume I read an A. So as soon as I read an A, what will I do? Just give me a second. I will push a blue ball in this stack. When I read the next A, I'll push another blue ball in the stack. When I read the next A, I'll push another blue ball in the next stack. I keep reading A's, and I keep inserting blue balls in the stack. So every time at the top of the stack. As soon as B comes, what we will do? As soon as B comes, I'll start popping these balls out. So for every A, I am putting the ball in. For every B, I am withdrawing one ball out. So when I saw the first B, I just removed this ball. When I saw the second B, I just removed this ball. Third B, remove this. Fourth B, remove this. So on and so forth. So at the end, if you see the bottom of the stack, so when you look at the last input of your read tape, if you are at the bottom of the stack, that means that your number of A's and B's were equal. But if something else happens, they were not equal. So let's take the condition where, let's say, A was greater than, let's say the condition where A was less than B. What will happen in this case? So for every A, I am just putting a blue ball here. Now what will happen? The number of A's is less than the number of B's. So I have more B's. So when I start withdrawing, so let's say I had here 5 A's, but I have here 10 B's. So for all the 5 A's, I have pushed in 5 balls. What I'm going to do now, for every B, I'm popping one ball out. So for 5 B's, I have popped 5 balls, right? I saw the bottom of the stack, but my 5 B's are still pending in the input. So when you hit the bottom of the stack, actually your input tape should have been, your input should be complete. So you should recall it even from the finite state automata. You should read the entire string, and after reading the entire string, you should be at a place which defines it to be final. So when you hit the bottom of the stack, if your input is not completely read, your string is rejected. What if the case when A was greater than B? Let's say there were 10 A's and there were only 5 B's. So for 10 A's, I'll just push 10 balls here. Now as soon as I see a B, I start popping out. So for first, second, third, fourth, fifth. So you see here my reading of the input tape is complete, but my stack is not empty. So again, it is rejected. So you can say that if I'm talking about a pushdown automata, when does it accept? When your input is completely read. And you see the bottom of the stack. And when will it reject? When one of these conditions fail. So one condition is input is completely read, but you don't see the bottom of the stack. So I'm writing at a complement of stack bottom. You don't see the bottom of the stack. Or you can also reject when you see the bottom of the stack, but there is some input which is pending. We have covered the basic principle on which a pushdown automata works. So it's exactly like a finite state automata. The only additional thing is this stack here, which you can use to store certain elements. We have also looked at this example for AN, BN. In the next lecture, we'll look at the formal definition of a pushdown automata.